We're at the Wilderness Gathering. We've literally just rocked up. We've got the fun task of pushing this bug out trailer to its location. Oh, what, in between the cars?
Yeah,
just
get through here.
Shit. I will work it out. Be a bit of a tight fit, but I'm sure it'll fit. I'm gonna have to sort of stop filming for now, but I thought I'd film us dragging this in. Because I don't think he's gonna. Yeah, I'm gonna do some pushing, so I'll ring you guys back when we're all sorted.
Hello! Right, today's the Friday. I was gonna say Saturday. It rained quite a bit last night. We set up all our stuff. And we got set up in the dark in the end. He's in his trailer, as you can see behind me, and I'm over here in my tarp. I'll take you guys for like a little tour in a sec. We had a good night's rest. We had a good wander around the show today. Last night I wandered to the woods and got horribly lost trying to find Ben Firestone Bushcraft and Tim the Dorset Woodcleaver. And had a drink with them, put the worlds to right, and then wandered back, had a good sleep, and woke up this morning, started with a coffee. And had like a lot of conversations with different people and brought a few bits. So hopefully I'll find a bit of time to show you guys what I bought. And it's been really good so far. The weather's been a bit crap. It's just pissing down with rain constant. Heavy dew, as he says. But other than that, can't complain. I've had a good time regardless. It's meant to be better weather tomorrow. So fingers crossed we'll see some sunshine. And then, hopefully tonight, maybe go out there and check out the live music and see a few more YouTubers. And, hopefully there's more to come. But I think there's a few more expected tomorrow and a few people come for the day on Sunday. So hopefully see what comes of it. Enjoy the rest of the time. I'm going to probably do a bit more filming later and I'll bring you guys back when I do.
Right, I thought I'd show you guys whilst the weather's holding off my setup. What I've done is 4 meter by 4 meter DD tarp, and a couple of poles, and then just got a fishing bed right in the centre, which is nice, comfy, nice thick self-inflating mat. Yeah, you know the drill, sleeping bag and bivvy. It's all my gear on the floor down here, bit of food and that. Yeah, it's nice and comfy under here. Got to say, with it being 4 meters by 4 meters, that's a nice sort of spacious place to kip. So it's not too bad. So put the camera netting up over here and sort of deflects any sort of coming wind. I was going to bring a tent, but then I couldn't be bothered, and I thought, why not be different? So it should be a lot quicker to take down. Literally take it straight down and then straight into the stuff sack. And then dry it out when I get back, so no doubt it'll still be wet. But yeah, it's been good. I think that, like I said, go out a bit later and try and catch a bit more film in them. And be good. I'll tell you what, actually, whilst I'm filming, I think I'll wander around to my dad's, film his setup. Here he is, preparing lunch, doing his thing.
Doing my thing.
Yeah, it's him. We've had quite a few people pop round and ask about it and that. But yeah, it's alright. Got this canvas tarp up. And sat down, chilling with a fire and an axe.
All you need.
Right. Like I say, I'll bring you guys back later and hopefully there'll be some more going on. But at the moment, it's just chew and lunch. Right, I thought I'd film us walking down from where we're camping down to the actual arena and the actual show itself. I'm going to speed it up so it's a bit quicker in that. So we'll wander down and then I'll show you guys around from sort of where we're camped. Phil, outdoor lip one. We got Camp Shaky over here. It's the crew. soaking up the sunshine. Give us a wave, guys.
It's good, isn't it?
Cue the drastic music.
Leaving in my little hole is fine. It's very comfortable.
Have a look at the beef. Look at that.
I've got to go and see. I've got to see this popping.
It's great. It's a great popping.
It's a proper Christy setup right there. All the lads sat down, soaking up the sun. You got a big enough kettle? So I'm up at the barn at the moment. This is where we come last year. Same sort of setup and idea as again last year. You bring all the gear that you want to sell, and you can like stick it on the deck. And then people sort of come and buy. And it's all various knives and different things here. This guy's selling like American MREs, all sorts of different gear. I brought a couple of bits from here. I got a Coleman dual fuel stove and a couple of other bits, but I'll probably catch that on video when I get back so I can sort of show you a bit more clearly. But I'll finish up here and then have a wander around and show you some more of the show and hopefully get a few more talks and stuff they're doing down there. Get some of that on video, show everyone on here. So it's the same sort of layout as before. Obviously you've got sort of traders and stalls all the way around. It follows it round in a sort of C shape. And you've got the food stalls and jerky and the jams, cheese for sale over there. And then, like last time, you head back down there and you're in the arena again. I'll have a quick look around some of these stalls again, I think, and then I'll bring you guys back, show you some other bits that's in the actual arena. Hopefully catch a few more bits. So I'm now in the main arena. Give you guys a pan round. Like I say, same again as last year. All the various stalls. And then, where is it? Back up that way. It's the Woodland Camping. And you've got some other stalls up there. Bumped into a few more YouTubers on the way down. But yeah, everybody's everywhere. And hopefully I can get a bit more footage, like I said, of people doing talks on various things. I'd check out the sheets, see if I can capture a good one. I'll show you guys at home.
And I normally have a sort of blunt end to my spoon, because I find that that's, even if I don't want it to look like that, that's at the end of when people are learning, they think, oh, I'm going to make a spoon so I can eat my soup or whatever around the campfire. And they start off with that in mind, and they end up with something that looks like a shovel. And then they're trying to dislocate their jaw to get it in. You'll be surprised how small you have to make it a really good eating spoon. Like, at the end of the day, go to your cutlery drawer and find your favourite, and you could almost lay that on and draw around it. That'll be a good starting point. Then what we want to try and do is draw that transition where it goes from the bowl of the spoon into the handle. It's a real advantage if you can avoid square corners. It's really difficult to get a clean cut. If you end up with square transitions in a piece of timber, it gives it a definite weak point, and that's where it normally snaps. Yeah. So if you can have nice flowing curves, you'll find that it'll be easier to carve, and it'll end up giving you a much stronger spoon. So proportion wise this is looking about right, so I might even leave a little bit for a little bit of decoration on the end there. So I've got my drawing. All I've got to do now is, like my mate said, he's really good at carving, he used to carve these fantastic animal heads in a piece of wood, and I'd say, how the hell do you do that? He'd say, it's easy, you just remove all the bits that don't look like a fox's head or whatever he was carving. I'd say, oh yeah, that's great. So that's basically what we're going to do, we're going to remove all the bits that don't look like a spoon. So the first easiest cut is to remove these long sides and get down to the width of our handle. So you'll notice that on my chopping block I've got a little notch, and that really helps because I'm going to be holding this at a slight angle and it stops that sort of skipping off my chopping block. So a little notch really helps. And then I'm going to start moving this out of the way so it doesn't get tangled up. Notice that I'm standing to one side, so if I miss I'm not going to cut my leg or anything. So I'm stood in this safe quarter, holding the axe head nice and close to the top, and then I put that series of nicks in again and then strike down. You can almost use the axe like a bit of a throw, and you can sort of almost just cleave the bits that you don't want off. And you'll notice that I'm always working at an angle, so I'm always working from the high point to the low point, so effectively working downwards, and that means that I won't be cutting up grain. If I was to turn this round and chop this way, before long I'd just split the side of my spoon off and I'd end up with like a chopstick. So always work from big to small, and then you'll find that it won't split off. Now this is easier for me now because I can see what I'm doing, but you can't see what I'm doing. And notice how I keep tucking my fingers in as much as possible. Don't be tempted to stick them out like that because you'll cut them off. If you tuck them in like that, the worst thing you'll do is cut the side of it. Okay? And it's up to you. Go as close to that pencil line or pen line as you feel comfortable. You know, obviously the more you remove with the axe now, the less you have to do with the knife. But, you know, it's up to you how confident you are. Then I'd turn it round and I'd take a little bit off these sides to get it closer to the shape of the size of the bowl of the spoon I want. And then's the tricky bit. How do we get in here? We were saying that we can't work back this way because we're going to split the side of the spoon off. So you've got two options. You can either go in sideways with a saw and put a little saw cut to prevent the wood from splitting. What I tend to do is I tend to use this little notch that I've got on my chopping block. There's a guy rope in the way really, but what I do is I strike like this. The end of my axe hits my chopping block and it prevents my axe from going too deep. This is slightly more advanced because I've still got the potential of slipping off the block and hitting my hand, so you've got to be a little bit more careful. But you'll notice that I'm not really lifting the axe very high, but it just gives me a little bit of control and allows me to work in there and put those little nicks. And you can move the spoon along. The more of those nicks in, the better really, because that's going to prevent those splits travelling when I work back the opposite way. So stick the axe in and notice how I just pry like that and allow those splits to just travel in a controlled manner. That's not too bad, isn't it? Okay, so that's one side done. To do the other side, it's a little bit more tricky, so I'll have to turn my back on you, I'm afraid. Come back this way. This is the safer one because obviously my hand isn't below where the axe is going, but if I lift the axe too high there is potential of cutting my fingers again, so I've got to be a bit careful. And it's like all things in life, the more you use your axe the more confident you become with it, to the point that it will almost become an extension of your hand. You won't really be thinking what you're doing, it will just be doing what you want it to do. But the main factor is to do that levering. That will really help you. If you try and swing the axe all the way, the amount of times you put little nicks in the backside of your bowl or your spoon, and even if it doesn't split then, you'll put little nicks that as it dries, they'll turn into cracks. So try and avoid going too close with the actual chopping, but just use that levering technique. Okay? So that's not looking too shoddy. Finally, what I'll do before I do anything else is I'll start to chop this curve into the spoon, and to do that I'll just hold the axe almost to the point where I'm just hitting the same spot on the chopping block, and I will just rotate the spoon and it will just create that radius that I'm looking for. What you can do is lock your elbow joint and use just your shoulder. So you lift your whole arm from your shoulder joint and you're going to drop it. And to improve that grip, rather than holding the knife square onto the timber, you want to crank it at a good 45 degree angle. And what that will do is it will allow you to get really nice, long, powerful cuts. And you'll notice that I look like I've got a sort of weird sort of twitch almost, but I'll be able to continue doing that for a much longer period of time without getting tired. Because at the end of the day, the muscle in there is a lot bigger than what's in my forearm. So that's quite a good technique. If you can get the hang of it, especially by angling that blade, you'll find that it's quite an efficient way of working. The biggest problem with that is that drawing is a long way away and often it's on the wrong side, so I can't see what I'm doing. So for most of the heavy cuts, even if like for things that don't really matter, for like removing the bark and things like that, that's not a bad grip to use. But for anything else, I tend to use what I call the chest lever grip. So that was our forehand grip. But to do the chest lever grip, what we do is we allow the knife to turn round so that the cutting edge is pointing back towards me. And then I lift both the spoon and the knife so that it crosses over in front of me. If you're doing it right, you should be able to see both of your thumbnails. And then what I do is I keep my hands tight to my body, I keep my elbows back, and I'm almost going to sort of do what looks like a chicken impression. I'm going to try and push my shoulder blades together so that they almost touch behind me. And you'll see that it's a really easy, well, easy, it's easy once you get the hang of it, but efficient way of working wood. For one, I can see what I'm doing, but the other thing is I'm using those shoulder muscles again, so it's a much more efficient way of working, and I can see what I'm doing the whole way through. The other thing that's nice about it is if I'm sitting down whittling with a group of mates, my mate who sat next to me is really safe because that knife never leaves that sort of bubble of my body zone, so it's a really quite safe grip to use. Very difficult to get a really crisp finish. Also, you'll find that it gets a little bit grubby at this stage. As you're handling it, it starts to go all manky colours. When it's dry, it won't take off the dirt off your hand so much and you'll get a much, much finer finish. The one last thing that I'd do is take some of this bulk of material out for where our bowl is going to be. Just before I do that, I put a slight chamfer all the way around at a sort of 45 degree angle. It makes it a lot easier to use the spoon knife and prevents the side of your spoon getting split out. But also it makes it a lot nicer to use as a spoon because those rounded edges are nicer on your mouth. If you leave it dead square, you end up getting sort of splinters. Now, as you take that chamfer, you might find that you just have to knock a little bit off that edge. And then we'll show you the next tool, which is the crook knife. You will need at least a curved blade or a gouge or something to remove that material. I personally prefer crook knives to gouges because if you use a gouge and you don't use it in the right way, you've got a hell of a long blade that can go in your leg or go in your arm or go in your hand. With a crook knife, it's a lot more sort of close quarter and a lot more control. You will need at least one crook knife that is your dominant hand, because normally you'll find the easiest way to work is back towards yourself. So I'm right-handed, so this is a right-handed crook knife. I don't tend to use double-edged tools because it just means that you can't apply any pressure on the back edge of that spoon knife, so all you do is cut your fingers. And I try and avoid spoon knives that are too big, and I try and avoid ones that have got a sharp point on the top, or, you know, on the end. I don't know why they make them like that. You can draw the shape on if you want, but what I tend to do, if you use this technique where you hold the crook knife in what I call an open fist grip, and then as you use the knife, you clench your fist, it swings the knife round and through, it sort of scribes that arc that you're looking for, but it also swings that cutting edge up and away from your thumb. So you hold your thumb underneath the spoon, and you start in the middle of the spoon and you start to draw the crook knife towards you. And if you just take little bites, you'll notice that as I work deeper, the bowl starts to get wider. Don't be tempted to start right on the outside and try and draw it all the way across. You'll be trying to remove such a great big chunk of wood that it's bound to slip and then you'll cut yourself. So little nibbles, just pretend that you're like a little beaver and you're just trying to little nibbles away, and it's actually quite enjoyable and quite pleasing. If I try and take one giant chunk, you'll just be cursing at it. And try and swing the knife through and all the way out the other side. If you stop halfway, you end up with this sort of buildup of fiber and it's really difficult to get rid of. So swing it all the way through and progressively work wider and deeper. Okay, just like so.
And keep your eyes wide, the chance will come again. And don't speak too soon for the week.
And in the distance, you can see two bearded beauties enjoying their natural environment, fire and pipe and beer. Through the shrubbery you must travel.
The Dorset Woodcleaver.
And Firestone Bushcraft.
And Firestone.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. How's it going?
We finally found bison on the bison farm after trying to have a good look around as to where they are.
It's only taken 2 years.
Stop moving. Hi guys, today's the Sunday. I didn't do much in the way of filming yesterday, so we had a good day out, look around and everything like we had the past couple of days. We're all packed up now, feeling pretty tired as you probably can tell, and gonna head home fairly soon. Gonna have a quick more wander around the show. I've packed all my gear away, as you guys can probably see, in a nice sort of tidy fashion. Yeah, the weather again today has been really nice, which has been pretty good for packing away. And it's gone, like a lot of people are sort of starting to like leave, or they've left. Other YouTubers and that have gone. I think most of Camp Shaky have left. My dad's packed all his trailer away. Yeah, but I think as a whole, everybody's had a very good time. And thoroughly enjoyed it. So I think we'll definitely try and do this again next year. And try and sort of go for the same spot again. But it's been really good. So I hope you guys have enjoyed the video. And please like and share and subscribe and all that. All right, thanks very much. It's Toby out.